little bit from the economy because you worked for Marco Rubio and the senator's very well-known position on Ukraine and what's happening there in Europe. I'd like to play very quickly for you some sound from Donald Trump talking about settling the Ukrainian war.
But the question here is, would you give Ukraine weapons and funding if you were elected?
I would sit down. Let me just put it a nicer way. If I'm president, I will have that war settled in one day, 24 hours.
How would you settle that war in one day?
Because I'll meet with Putin, I'll meet with Zelensky. They both have weaknesses and they both have strengths. And within 24 hours, that war will be settled. It'll be over. It'll be absolutely over.
Do you want Ukraine?
Okay, I'll set aside the idea that it's going to be settled in 24 hours. But there are a lot of Republicans in the House and the Senate who are not aligned with the president on Ukraine. How do you see narratively and geopolitically Trump navigating those Republicans like Marco Rubio, who are on the record strongly supporting Ukraine, and in the face of, you know, the reality that, you know, Trump really has much more of an alignment on this issue with Putin than he does with, you know, U.S. senators and Republicans?
Well, I think that's a ridiculous way to frame the issue. Look, everybody agrees.
Why is that ridiculous?
That President Trump has more alignment with Putin?
Yes, because he is saying some of the, and I think he says that because Donald Trump has said some of the same things Putin has said about letting Russia keep some of Ukraine. So that's why he said that. So why do you think that's
so? The number one geostrategic challenge that the United States faces, that the world faces right now, is a mercantilist country in China that is a cancer on the world system. Everybody going back to the Obama administration has said we need to pivot to Asia. The Trump administration said we need to pivot to Asia. The Biden administration says we need to pivot to Asia. Right now, the war in Ukraine is a gigantic use of resources, of weapons. We're running low on weapons that are critical to be able to actively deter China from going across the Taiwan Strait. We need to find a way to end the war in Ukraine. President Trump is correct about that. That's going to be a negotiated settlement. It's absurd to think
you're going to give Donbass and those territories that
Do you think that Ukraine should be able to retake the Crimea? Is that a realistic war?
Since it was taken from them, they were invaded, yes.
And so we should be supporting the Ukrainians.
We should be supporting an ally.
All the way until they retake the Crimea, even if that keeps us totally distracted from China.
We don't
allow China to go across the Taiwan.
Can I just say something?
We can do two
live
things.
In a world.
Mike,
well, we can't. That's actually what the Washington
establishment
says.
No, it's not Washington.
We can walk and we can chew gum at the same time.
They say we're out of time.
We can't do that. We have to choose.
I think real things are happening in Ukraine and Russia as we speak right now. 50,000 troops. Russia has amassed 50,000 troops without having to take any troops out of Ukraine. These are North Korean troops that are now training. They're training for a counteroffensive to take back parts of Russia that Ukraine has captured because they've made inroads into the region. You say, should, you know, Ukraine be able to, you know, take back Crimea? And I guess to bring it home for the American people, this would be like if Mexico popped up and said, we want Texas back. And it's like, Texas is America. What are y'all talking about? And if the Mexican government took parts of Texas, and would you react kindly to one of our allies saying, well, you know, you just need to let some of them keep it?
We do not live in the unipolar moment anymore. This is not the 1990s. If America doesn't choose, if America doesn't prioritize, a very dangerous world is going to end up with the United States being supplanted.
So and just so, one quick question. So you would let Mexico keep parts of Texas?
I think we could handle Mexico, and we will handle Mexico right now.
Okay.
Right now, if this... If
all right, Texas,
all right,
y'all
Texas,
better watch out.
Mike is going to let the ground go. Let the ground go in pursuit of China. Mike Needham, thank you very much.
Thanks for having me.
Your time. Later, folks, we're going to look at how the Trump agenda will play out on Capitol Hill with California Congressman Eric Swalwell and New York Congressman...
One of the archetypal stories of Donald Trump is how he was groomed by Russia. According to a former KGB spy, Trump showed up on the Soviet Union's radar in 1977 when he married Czech model Ivana Zelenkova, his first wife. And he allegedly became the target of a spying operation overseen by Czechoslovakia's intelligence service in cooperation with the KGB. Noting that, the feeling was that he was extremely vulnerable intellectually and psychologically, and he was prone to flattery. And Donald Trump's first trip to Russia in 1987 to explore a hotel deal was brokered by a Soviet tourist agency that was essentially a branch of the KGB. Just weeks after that, word started to spread that Trump might run for president as he started displaying his pro-Russia lean, a trait he took to the White House, effectively delivering Russian President Vladimir Putin his driving dream, a man in Washington. Fast forward to today. It's clear that Donald Trump is bent on returning us to the 1980s culturally and politically. So instead of Charles in charge, get ready for Vlad in charge, because his junior partner, Donald Trump, is back. On Thursday, Putin congratulated Trump, calling him courageous and a real man, and said he's ready and willing to talk or meet even before the inauguration. And members of Russia's elite are already declaring, "We have won," and crowing about a new world order. And of course, Trump is already right back to acting like he's Russia's man in the White House. During a call with Ukraine's President Zelensky, Trump let Elon Musk make a surprise, unplanned appearance on the call. Elon Musk has also been chatting with Putin. One thing that's clear is that Donald Trump's election raises major concerns about Ukraine's ongoing fight against Russia. He's refused to say whether he wants Ukraine to win, and that combined with an isolationist Republican Party eager to withdraw funding to Ukraine, it will soon get very hard not to argue that Russia ultimately won the Cold War and Vladimir Putin is in charge. Joining me now is David Rothkopf, columnist for The Daily Beast and host of the Deep State Radio podcast. David, on that call, it strikes me that that was Donald Trump, mafia style, making Vladimir Zelensky beg Elon Musk for Starlink, to try to beg for his life, because that's the position he's in. His statement after his readout was the meeting was great. He's now having to kiss up to Donald Trump and Elon Musk just to live. Your thoughts?
Well, I think he has no choice. The United States is the critical lifeline for Ukraine. And so whatever he can get in way of U.S. support, he's going to try and get. But I can tell you, I've spoken to people in Ukraine, people who are associated with Ukraine in the past 2 days, and as distraught as many Democrats in the United States were, the Ukrainians were absolutely devastated. They've been fighting a war for 2 years. They've watched their friends, their families, their children, their fathers, their sons die in that war, and they know that Donald Trump is not going to support them in the way that Joe Biden did. And that Donald Trump has already said that he wants to seek a negotiation. And the kind of terms he's talking about are Putin's terms. And, during the last couple of weeks of the campaign, there were stories about Trump being on the phone regularly with Putin and Elon Musk being on the phone regularly with Putin. J.D. Vance is a Putin fan. And so of all the big changes in U.S. foreign policy that are coming, one of the very biggest is going to have to do with Ukraine. And I'm afraid it's going to have potentially tragic consequences.
Oh, absolutely. I think there's no doubt about that. I mean, in some ways, I was thinking about the fact that in many ways, Joe Biden might be remembered as the last American president. You know, Donald Trump is in many ways simply an underboss to Vladimir Putin. The big man in that relationship is clearly Putin, not him. And then on this side of the aisle, the big man in the relationship is Elon Musk and the other former white South Africans who are sort of remaking a country like the one they left and making themselves extravagantly rich the way Putin does. So I want you to just talk a little bit about what it means. I want to put this Le Monde, it was a very sad article that just it strikes you as, wow, tragic. The end of an American world, Le Monde. This is the French paper Le Monde, and they said it marks the end of an American era, that of an open superpower committed to the world, eager to set itself up as a democratic model. And it's the famous shining city on the hill extolled by President Ronald Reagan. The model had been challenged over the past 2 decades. Now Trump's return is putting a nail in its coffin. The Economist saying Europe needs to wake up, look after itself. The new world is the BRICS world, is it not? Brazil, Russia, India, China, and Saudi Arabia, BRICS. And Russia is the R in BRICS, and they are ascendant.
Yeah, well, you know, when Donald Trump was president before, we saw that a centerpiece of his foreign policy was effectively dismantling the previous 80 years of U.S. foreign policy. We built up alliances. He sought to undermine the alliances. The biggest alliance, NATO, he talked about pulling out of. We promoted democracy. They deleted the promotion of democracy from the State Department website, and he instead kissed up to autocrats around the world. What we have heard from him in the intervening 4 years suggests that he's only going to double down on this and that we're going to see more of the same behavior. And so people in Europe are deeply afraid of what this means, not just for Ukraine, but for the Atlantic Alliance, which has been the single most important stabilizing force on the planet Earth since the end of World War II. But allies in Asia are also
So folks, it's all projection, right? They're trying to argue that Trump did it the right way, that it was clean, that he was nice, that he won, and that all his claims of impropriety vanished, guys, when he won that night, right? But we're all kind of moving past some things. Now, I'm not suggesting that the things I'm going to talk about change the overall result. But we remember what happened on Election Day. And this is not from me or from you. I'm just some guy. I'm a commentator. I'm not a reporter. I'm not a journalist. I'm a commentator. But what Raffensperger said, confirmed by law enforcement, was that on Election Day, at multiple polling stations in Atlanta, there were bomb threats made. Non-credible. They turned out to be BS, but they still caused chaos and shutdowns, and the stations were kept open longer, but who knows how many people left but couldn't come back because maybe they worked that night. How many people couldn't get to vote because of that? And the calls were said to have come from Russia. And we know how much control Vladimir Putin has over Russian society. We know that Donald Trump once had classified documents that maybe he sold or gave to Russia, exchanged for all sorts of favors. We don't know. But what we do know is that those polling stations were in majority black parts and Democratic voting parts of Atlanta. So in a potentially Georgia didn't end up being all that close. But if it was like last time, who knows? So you could see here, all the talk about impropriety and fraud and all of that went away. When if there was anything that day, and we need more information, I'm sure that there is ongoing investigations about what happened with the threats. It was from Russia to help Trump. And so everyone trying to downplay the Trump-Putin connections and all of that are being very silly. Again, Republicans always accuse Democrats of awful things. And when they do, it's usually because they're doing the things that are awful.